STEM fans, are you ready? Let's hear it for the world-class NASA STEM Stars team. From NASA centers across the country, we present Kurt Leucht.
Well, hello, NASA STEM stars, fans out there. My name is Lynn Dotson. I'm coming to you live from Kennedy Space Center, and welcome to our 72nd episode of NASA STEM stars. Kurt, thank you so much for joining us today. How are you doing, and how does it feel to be a NASA STEM star?
Hi, Lynn. Thank you for having me. It's wonderful to be here. It's wonderful to be a NASA STEM star. I'm excited.
Awesome. We are so happy you're here. So let's talk a little bit about Kurt. Kurt Leucht is a software engineer at Kennedy Space Center. He's going to share about his background, his career experiences, and the amazing work he does for NASA. And finally, you guys, be sure to stick around because he will answer your questions. And I have a really fun challenge for you all to do. So let's kick it right off and start talking about Kurt. Why don't you do us a favor and tell us all about who you are, what makes you the person you are, and a little bit more about your interest.
All right. Well, my interests and hobbies include singing. I do quite a bit of singing. I grew up singing in my church. And my parents sung in our church. And so my sister and I sung in our church. And also community theater. I grew up singing in community theater. And so as an adult, I still sing in my church and I still sing in the local community theater. So that's kind of my favorite hobby that takes up most of my time right now.
That's awesome. I really knew I liked you for some reason. You actually have a lot. You and I have a lot in common.
Yeah.
I was a singer also, and I was in theater. So we had chatted about that. So it's really neat. This is probably really comfortable for you. Yeah.
Yeah.
Very cool. So did any of these hobbies help you with your choosing what you want to do with your career? Has it helped you in your career?
I would say it helps me with the outreach that I like to do because, you know, I'm comfortable on stage and in front of people. And so it's definitely helped me. I know a lot of my coworkers are kind of afraid to do outreach and speak to, you know, students and adults. And, you know, that
well, students, just doesn't
bother
students
me.
Can
so
be scary. I was a teacher. Students
so can
be
adults.
Very scary. Yeah, that's very true. That's very true. So what we're going to do to just kind of break the ice is we're going to do something called a new segment called Lightning Round. And I'm going to ask you rapid fire questions and you're going to give me a one word response. So let's see how many questions you can get within 30 seconds. Are you ready?
Let's do it.
Okay, so let's check.
Time for NASA STEM Stars Lightning Round.
I love
and the
that
crowd
intro.
Goes wild. Wow.
Yes. So they're going to be putting up 30 seconds on the clock, but I just want to show you that there is a little bit of a competitive side here. There is a leaderboard, and we want to see that leaderboard. Yes, you looks like you have to beat top number 10 questions. No pressure, but I have a feeling that you are ready for this. So here
no
we
pressure,
go.
But I have to beat 10. All right.
Yeah, you had to beat 10. So it's you and me. We're going to work together as a team. So 30 seconds on the clock. Here we go. Skydive or scuba dive?
Skydive.
Are you a talker or a texter?
Texter.
Okay. Pizza or pickles?
Pizza.
Early bird or night owl?
Night owl.
Tie-dye or bow tie?
Tie-dye.
City or country?
Country.
Vacation or staycation?
Vacation.
Food truck or restaurant?
Restaurant.
Tennis shoes or flip-flops?
Tennis shoes. Oh, I didn't get the last one, did I?
No, you got it. You got it. I'm going to count it. So yeah, you are actually tied for first place. So everybody, yes, show some love in the chat for Kurt. That is
a tie
awesome.
Is a shared win.
Exactly. So let's go back to the country or city. What did you say you preferred,
country
or city?
Oh yeah, okay. I'm not a fan of big cities.
You know, neither am I. I think we're a lot alike. I grew up in Missouri, and I think we have a tie there. But so let's talk about where you grew up. So sure. That probably influences why you like the country so much.
Yeah, I grew up in the Midwest in the middle of Illinois, which is very rural and very country. There's a lot of corn in rural Illinois, as you can see from the photo. A lot of kids, when they grow up in a small town in a rural community, they kind of diss it while they're there. You know, I can't wait to get it, you know, out of this small town. But I wasn't like that. I loved the small town, and I still like living in a small town and having a community that, you know, supports and you know, is comfortable with each other and that sort of thing. So yeah, I'm definitely a small town kind of guy.
That's definitely me too. The cities make me a little bit nervous, but they're just, everybody's too fast paced. So you started your love for engineering basically at a really young age. Talk about what were some things you did as a kid and what made you inspired to get to be an engineer?
Yeah, my mom loves to tell the story about how I was tearing things apart, like the toaster or the clock or, you know, a watch or something like that. And one of my favorite toys when I was little was an Erector set. Now it's much older than me. The Erector set is like a 50s, 60s kind of toy. And I was a 70s kid, but, so I inherited an Erector set, and I still love the ability to just take a bunch of parts and put them together into, you know, something that I want it to turn into, rather than just having to follow directions and it only makes one thing. An Erector set can make anything. And that's true with a lot of toys these days. So there's a lot of great toys today that do the same thing. I was also into computers. And when I was a preteen, I got my first computer for Christmas. It was an Apple IIe.
Wow.
This is the early 80s. And the Apple IIe was like the premier computer of the day. In this picture, I'm playing a game like any preteen does with a computer. But what's not shown in this picture is I spent a lot of time learning to program on that computer. I had some software that helped me learn how to program, and I just did it on my own for fun. I got some catalogs in the mail. This was, you know, before the internet. If you can imagine, kids, that there's an actual time before the internet where computers weren't connected to phone lines and internet, and you had to get your information from magazines and the library and stuff like that. So I remember getting some magazines, and they had some example programs, and I could type those into my computer, and they wouldn't always work, and so you'd have to go figure out where the problem was and debug the program. So I learned kind of how to be a software engineer very, very young in life.
Sounds like it. So I think that there's also a few hobbies that you did as a kid, maybe launching some rockets. You actually work at Kennedy, so I'm sure you've seen some cool rocket launches. But
yeah, I played with rockets when I was growing up too. You could go to the store and you could buy the Estes rocket kits, and you could, you know, glue them together. And I made my own rockets. I took, you know, empty paper towel tubes and things like that, and I glued together my own rocket designs. I even made a space shuttle, because I was really into the space shuttle as a teenager when the shuttle was going, you know, gangbusters in the mid 80s. I get into rocketry at a young age, and so the toys that I played with and the hobbies that I had at that age kind of, and the fact that I was a tinkerer and able to take things apart and put them back together, and they still worked. I mean, that was kind of a key part of the story that my mom likes to tell. He took apart the toaster just to see how it worked, you know, inside, and then he put it back together and it still worked. So that kind of destined me to be an engineer, I think.
That's, yeah, I mean, what a fascinating story. And you definitely were destined to work at NASA. So one of the questions that said, I guess they're thinking Titusville is not much of a city, or it is a city, but it says, how did you get used to city life when you came from the country? So Titusville, it's a little bigger than your hometown.
Titusville's in between city and country for me. We it has some big city conveniences, but it doesn't have the big city traffic. So, yeah, it's a lot bigger than the small town that I grew up in, but it's still not the big city. Like every time I have to drive over to Orlando, which is a big city in Central Florida, I get a little uncomfortable with the traffic and that sort of thing.
Tall buildings. Yeah. I prefer also staying on the Space Coast. But another question, what kind of programming did you use when you were a kid? Was there a particular, I know you kind of talked about it.
Yeah. On the Apple, the programming language was a basic programming language, and technically it was called AppleSoft Basic. But you could also buy programs and boot up another language and program in another language. But I stuck with, DOS commands and basic commands when I was that age. It wasn't until later in my career, when I was more an adult in the workforce, that I started really getting into the languages of like C and C++ and Java and Python and things like that.
Wow. I've kind of heard of some of that, but I'm definitely not a programmer. So it's very fascinating what you do. So, it went right over my head. So how did you get, so kind of after you're growing up in this small town in Illinois, and then you said, I'm going to go to a technology school. So I've heard of this school because I'm actually, it's from Missouri. So yeah. Talk a little bit about your technology school and your steps to getting to programming and eventually NASA.
Sure. I went to an engineering school in Missouri called, at the time it was called University of Missouri-Rolla. Now it's called Missouri S&T, Missouri Science and Technology. It's mostly engineers. There are other degrees there, but the majority of the students are in engineering. And while I was in college, I saw opportunities to work for companies and basically take a short break from college to work for a company as an intern, and then go back to college, and then go back to the company. And so I did multiple internships. I applied for an internship with NASA, and I actually got the job. So while I was in college getting my degree, I took several breaks, one semester at a time, breaks from college to work full time. Some students are a little afraid to take a break from school and work full time. That's kind of a big step for some students, but I highly encourage students to do it. They pay well. So you can actually help pay for your own college and give your parents a break, assuming that they're paying for your college. It actually gives you this wonderful experience in the workforce that helps you actually, college actually kind of goes quicker and easier when you actually get this sense of what the real world workforce is like and what you're going to be needing to be doing after you graduate. It really kind of helps you understand what your future is going to be like when you get to a little peek at the workforce I did. And I had a wonderful boss when I was interning, and also when I got hired full time after I graduated. I graduated with my electrical engineering degree, which isn't technically a software degree, but my boss, because software degrees weren't that popular back then. Well, this is 30 years ago, so times have changed. But my boss, Gary, he gave me some wonderful advice when I was an intern and when I was a new hire at NASA. He said, follow your passion. If you don't whistle on your way to work, and if you don't whistle on your way home, then you may not be in the right place, and don't continue to work in the wrong place if that's really not where your passion is, and if that's not really where you're having fun and interested in the work and passionate about the work. And so a few years later, Gary kind of came up again as somebody who was kind of directing my career path, because when I was working for him, I was doing hardware, electrical engineering type of work. But in my spare time for him, for the lab, I was also doing all kinds of software things to try and bring tools to the lab to help them, you know, increase their productivity and things like that. And so Gary saw that my passion was software. And when a big software project came to Kennedy, he saw that. And even though it meant me possibly leaving his group, he told me about this project. And he said that if I really wanted to be a software guy instead of a hardware guy that just dabbles in software in his spare time, that was the project to be in. So I really owe it to Gary for having the, you know, the maturity to tell one of his workers about another opportunity in another group.
Yeah, that's, well, the mentors definitely are, I was going to ask that, mentors are definitely people that help guide us to where we end up. And I know a lot of my teachers did the same. So that's a really neat story to hear about Gary. And you actually ended up going into the firing room, it sounds like. I think there's a picture of you working in the firing room. And first, let's, for the viewers who don't know what the firing room is, maybe you want to explain kind of this picture.
Yeah. So I took Gary's advice and I moved over to a software group who was developing the software that runs in the firing room. And for those that don't know what the firing room is, when you watch a launch on NASA TV and, you know, they're going to show you the rocket on the pad, but then they're going to cut to a bunch of engineers staring at computer screens. That's the firing room. And so the computer screens that these engineers are looking at and interacting with to monitor the state of the rocket and to control, you know, pumps and motors and, you know, all the equipment that's out at the pad supporting this launch, that's the software that I was able to work on in the firing room. And just kind of, having a software job, that's where my passion kicked in. And you know, I really took off and just kind of excelled in that job. Not that I wasn't excelling in my previous job, but it was definitely a passion, and that difference showed in my work.
I definitely want you to now talk. I think this is probably the coolest thing you're a part of. There's a place called Swamp Works at Kennedy Space Center. And I think there's a few pictures of that. But I definitely want you to share about Swamp Works and what you're doing now as an engineer at Kennedy Space Center.
Yeah, Swamp Works is a research and development laboratory at NASA. And we are researching and developing new technologies that could be used on the moon and eventually could be used on Mars. And so one example of that is a robot that is capable of digging under the ground in order to get to the frozen water that's hiding under the surface. That's a technology, that's a robot that NASA needs to figure out. We need to invent it. We need to research and develop and test. And this is one of the projects that Swamp Works has been working on for the last number of years. And so I've had the opportunity to move from the firing room command and control software project into the Swamp Works research and development lab and help them develop their software for different technologies like the excavation robot. Another example of a Swamp Works project that I've worked on not too long ago was a set of robots called the Swarmies. And these are small, inexpensive robots that you send a whole bunch of small, inexpensive robots to do a task rather than just sending one really big, really expensive robot. And so I've worked on software for swarming robots, which is another really fun project.
So is that based on like insects? Like I know insects,
exactly.
Some insects swarm. Oh, okay.
Exactly. The swarmies are based on ant behavior, the way that ants move around in their environment looking for food and water, and then they bring that food and water back to the nest. And the way that ants communicate, you know, is a one to many means of communication. And we've tried to mimic that ant behavior in these swarmies and see if we could implement an ant-inspired behavior, including communication techniques, into a set of robots. And it worked pretty well. I think NASA could use it on the moon or on Mars someday to look for resources and maybe even collect resources and gather.
That's what I was just going to say. So it makes sense that maybe the swarmies would go first. They're going to find the resources. And then Razor, which it sounds like we have a video of it actually working. So hopefully we can get that plane because it is a neat robot. So we'll play that and maybe you could talk a little bit about how it works.
Yeah, once the resource is found, in theory, you would send a device to go dig up the resource. And so here's some video showing Razor digging in our lab where we have this simulated moon dust. And it's basically crushed volcanic rock, a lot of crushed volcanic rock, 100 or more tons of crushed volcanic rock. And the way the really special thing about this robot is the counter rotating drums, where it's got drums in the front and it's got drums in the rear. And when they're digging, they're rotating in opposite directions. And that actual counter rotation of those digging forces actually cancel some of those forces out, which allows a very lightweight robot to dig. Cause when you think about when we dig here on the Earth, we use really, really heavy, massive, giant machines, and they're using that weight in order to offset the arm that's doing the digging. And we're just not going to be able to send really, really giant, massive robots to the moon. So we've had to figure out a new way to dig on the moon.
Yeah,
it's a fun project.
It looks really cool. I've actually got to see it do its thing, and it's just so neat. I can't wait till it gets to the moon someday. That was just a prototype though, right? We haven't actually made
that's
the right,
just a
the
prototype
one.
Yeah, we're working on the lunar version right now.
Very cool. So because your job is so cool, I know you do a lot of outreach, and so I wanted to maybe kind of give, there's a picture of you actually doing your outreach and spreading the NASA word. Where was this and what kind of places do you get to go to talk about your story?
Well, most of the time I just go to local schools and local clubs and, you know, in the area. But occasionally a group will request a NASA speaker for a very special event that is not local. This picture was actually taken in Poland at a software developers conference that I was asked to come to. And they actually, the company who ran the conference, they actually paid for everything. They paid for the travel and the hotel and the meals and everything. Occasionally, you know, NASA lets us go on, you know, trips like that.
Yeah.
Especially if they're paid for by the company that's requesting it. So yeah, I've been able to speak in Poland. I've been able to speak in Sweden and also Berlin, Germany over the years.
So you're well-traveled. So there's a one question that came in and I thought it was really neat. It's from one of the students. Did the swarmies use a biologist to help develop that technology based on the ants? Did you guys talk with
exactly? Yes, that's a very good question, and the answer is yes. So the way it happened was the biologists were studying the ants first for other reasons, and they basically studied the ants out in the wild, and they used techniques to follow ants. You know, they would mark an ant and then follow one individual ant and basically mark its path and its territory and that sort of thing. And then they would go back to the lab and they would take all that data and basically come up with an algorithm that mimicked what that ant did, that ant's behavior. And then they tried it on some robots in their lab, and they tried to figure out if they could make robots do it. And then we heard about it, and is actually one of my interns for the FireGram software. He was working in this ant biology lab, working on the robots. And we kind of brainstormed and realized that there's a real space application for that technology. So we wrote a proposal and it got funded and the swarmies were born.
That's awesome. Yeah, those are some of my favorite robots because the biology is my background. So another one that came in might be from a teacher. How do you request someone to speak? It sounds like these teachers want you to come maybe speak to them. So you know how to do that? I know the answer if you don't, but I'm sure you do.
It's called NASA Speakers Bureau. Just go to your favorite internet browser and, you know, search for NASA Speakers Bureau, and there's a website, and you fill out a form, and they'll try and find a NASA speaker in your area that can speak for you.
Very cool. Well, thank you so much. So I think what we're going to do is we are going to talk about what's next week, because next week we want people to tune in. We do have an episode, but before I get to that, I also want to give these kids a challenge. One of the coolest challenges I found as an educator is they actually could design their own robotic insect. And how perfect is that? So you guys, your mission, please, 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 we want to see your mission accomplished. So you're going to design a robotic insect. The chat will have the link. It is a JPL activity, and you are going to actually design a robotic insect. And if you could, please share on social media with hashtag NextGenSTEM. And definitely also another thing is tune in next week. And if you haven't subscribed to this channel, please do so now. Next week, we have Margaret Dominguez. She is an optical engineer, and she will be on NASA STEM Stars in Espanol on September 15th at 2 p.m. Eastern. So I want to leave this awesome episode with, and I'm going to turn it back over to Kurt just for any last moments, last words to say to maybe inspire the kids, give them some advice that are tuning in that maybe want to be you someday.
Thank you for the opportunity. My advice to students is going to be follow your passion, do what you love. If you find a job that is like a fun hobby, then, you know, you'll never get tired of your job. If you have fun at your job, you'll never get tired of it. You know, there's the old kind of traditional joke that, you know, people go to work and they hate their jobs, and they can't wait to, you know, for the, you know, 5 o'clock to come around so that they can leave and get away from their job. But that should not be your life. Your life should be, you know, whistle on your way to work and whistle on your way home, which is what my old boss Gary used to say. Yes. So definitely follow your passion. And that's the same for college degrees. Don't pick a college degree because, you know, it pays more than another one. Pick a college degree because that's your passion and that's what you want to do for the rest of your life.
Awesome. Such great advice, Kurt. We have really enjoyed having you on today's episode. And again, I want to tell the audience, please push that subscribe button. We want you to tune into every one of our episodes. They are archived, but we want you to tune in live because we love getting questions from our audience. So thank you so much, Kurt. Have a great rest of your week. And thanks, NASA STEM Star fans. Bye.
Bye. Thank you for having me. I had fun.